May I first request Professor Nagaswamy to offer flowers to Goddess Saraswati, and may I request Sri Rajiv Malhotra ji to please join him at the other end. We now have Samaveda chanting by Ganesh and Vadyar.
Om Namah Samavedaya Om Agna Ayahi Vitaye Grenano Havyadataye Nihota Satsi Barhishi Om Hau 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 Setung Stara Setung Stara Dustaran 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 Dane Nadanam Asmi prathamaja rita Akrodhe Nakrodham Akrodhe Nakrodham Hau 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 Purvande Amritasya na Sehetum stara dustara Dustaran, dustaran, shraddhaya, shraddham, shraddhaya, shraddham. Shraddhaya Shraddham Hau 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 Yoma Dadadi Saide Vama Satyenanritam Hau 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 Ahamanna Manna Madantama Yeh tadamritam Yeh tadamritam Svargaccha 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 Jyotirgaccha 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 Sehetu
Devaram rendition. Devaram is the traditional devotional poetry and music of Tamil Nadu that goes back to thousands of years. Today we have Oduvar Sadguna Nadan from Kapalishwarar Kovil singing a Manik Vachagar composition for us.
Trichitrambalam Manik Vachagar Brahman இறைவனை நாயகனாகவும் தன்னை நாயகியாகவும் பாவித்து திருவம்பாவை என்ற பாடல்களை அருளி செய்திருக்கிறார்கள். இந்த மார்கழி மாதத்திலே அதை இங்கே பாடுவது பொருத்தமாகும் என்று அதை எடுத்துக்கொண்டு திருச்சிற்றம்பரம்
ஆதியும் அந்தமும்
illa arum perum jodiyam paad ketteyum vaadthadangan aadiyum andamum illa arum perum jodiyam paad ketteyum vaadthadangan மாதேவளருதியோ வன்செவியோ நின்செவிதான் மாதேவளருதியோ வன்செவியோ நின்செவிதான் மாதேவன் வார்கழல்கள் வாழ்த்திய வாழ்த்தொறி போய் மாதேவன் வார்கழல்கள் வாழ்த்திய வாழ்த்தொலி போய் வீதிவாய் கேட்டலுமே விம்மி விம்மி மெய் மறந்து வீதிவாய் கேட்டலுமே விம்மி விம்மி மெய் மறந்து போதாரமளியின் மேல் நின்றும் புரண்டு எங்கன் ஏதேனுமாகாள் ஏதேனுமாகாள் கிடந்தாள் என்னே என்னே ஈதே என் தோழி பரிசேலொரியம் பாவாய் போற்றி அருளுக நின் ஆதியாம் பாதமலர் போற்றி அருளுக நின் அந்தமாம் செந்தளீர்கள் போற்றி எல்லா உயிர்க்கும் தோற்றமாம் பொற்பாதம் போற்றி எல்லா உயிர்க்கும் போகமாம் பூங்கழல்கள் போற்றி எல்லா உயிர்க்கும் ஈராம் இணையடிகள் போற்றி மால் நான் முகனும் காணாத புண்டரீகம் போற்றியாம் உய ஆட்கொண்டருளும் பொன்மலர்கள் போற்றியாம் உய ஆட்கொண்டருளும் பொன்மலர்கள் போற்றியாம் மார்கழி நீர் ஆடேலோர் எம்பாவாய் எம்பாவாய் திருச்சிற்றம்பலம்.
Thank you very much. May I now request Professor Jyotirmay Tripathi to please introduce our guests.
Dear friends, Suprabhatam. I am Jyotirmay from the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences of this institute. It's truly a humbling experience to introduce the speakers of this inaugural session, who I believe have changed the way we imagine our Indian selves, our civilization and culture, our nation and nationhood, our being and becoming, and in more ways than one, have given us the tools and vocabulary to develop a positive sense of ourselves. The very idea of a Swadeshi Indology is to return the colonial gaze and its manifestations in sections of academia. It is predicated on the need for going beyond borrowed and imported models and creating a forum where India, in spite of its differences within, can discover its core and articulate itself. True decolonization depends on developing Swaraj, the agentic self, which can establish its contours within Indic perspectives. The speakers of this session are the sutradharas of this enterprise. I am going to introduce them one by one. So let me have the pleasure of introducing Sri Ballav Rup Chand Bhansali, who is an investment banker and the co-founder of Enam Securities and Enam Group. He is also the founder director at Flame and a trustee of the Bombay Stock Exchange. He has also served as director of Axis Bank Limited. He has lectured throughout his career in the behavioral field and has published several articles in professional and other magazines. He is a keen student of India's spiritual and cultural traditions and modern subjects such as development economics, behavioral science, communication, etc. Sri Mohandas Pai requires no introduction. He was an integral part of the Infosys team that enabled the first listing of an India-registered company on NASDAQ and the first sponsored secondary offering of American depository shares by an Indian company. He was voted the CFO of the year in 2001 by IMA India. Mohan has been actively working with regulators to improve the business ecosystem. He was a member of the Kelkar Committee, constituted by the Ministry of Finance, Government of India for reforming direct taxes, the Non-Resident Taxation Committee, and the High Powered Committee on E-Commerce and Taxation. Mohan believes that illiteracy and lack of education are the roots of social backwardness and has worked extensively in the basic education sector. As chairman, Manipal Global Education Services, he brings to it his insights of the Indian system, his international exposure, his deep understanding of the financial system, his experience in building an international brand, and the personal credibility he enjoys with business leaders. Thank you, sir. Professor K.S. Kannan is a professor at the Center for Ancient History and Culture at Jain University, Bangalore, and is the academic director of Swadeshi Indology Conference Series. He is a former director of Karnataka Sanskrit University and the author of multiple monographs on Sanskrit literature and Indian philosophy. You are welcome, sir. Dr. V.S. Ramachandran, who will be joining us shortly, is director of the Center for Brain and Cognition and distinguished professor with the Psychology Department and Neurosciences Program at the University of California, San Diego. Ramachandran initially trained as a doctor at Stanley Medical College, Madras, and subsequently obtained a PhD from Trinity College at the University of Cambridge. His early work was on visual perception, but he is best known for his experiments in behavioral neurology, which, despite their apparent simplicity, have had a profound impact on the way we think about the brain. He has been called the Marco Polo of neuroscience by Richard Dawkins and the modern Paul Broca by Eric Kandel. The President of India conferred on him the second highest civilian award and honorific title on him, the Padma Bhushan. And Time magazine named him on their list of the 100 most influential people in the world. He is the author of the acclaimed book Phantoms in the Brain that has been translated into 9 languages and formed the basis for a 2-part series on Channel 4 TV in the UK. In addition, he has an interest in history and archaeology. Honorable Justice N. Kumar was born in 1954. He enrolled as an advocate in 1976 and practiced in the High Court of Karnataka. Later, he was appointed as additional judge of the Karnataka High Court in 2000 as a permanent judge in the year 2001. He is also the president of Karnataka Judicial Academy. You are welcome, sir. Swami Vigyananandji is the founder and global chairman of World Hindu Foundation. He is a towering practitioner, intellectual of Sanatan Dharma, and a distinguished scholar of Hinduism. He's an intellectual mentor and strategic guide for hundreds of distinguished activists and organizations operating multitude of Hindu empowerment and awareness projects with a worldwide scope comprising Asia-Pacific, European, South Asian, African, and American regions. He did his bachelor's in engineering from IIT Kharagpur. You are welcome, sir. Dr. R. Nagaswamy is a world-renowned expert in the field of art, numismatics, music, dance, public affairs, ancient law, and society.
He was an expert witness in the London High Court on behalf of the government of India, and it was his testimony which helped us bring back the Nataraj back to Tamil Nadu. He was also the expert witness in the Allahabad Court, Lucknow, in the Ram Janmabhoomi Babri Masjid case, deposing for full 26 days before the court confirmed the existence of a temple beneath the mosque based on the excavation undertaken by the Archaeological Survey of India. An archaeologist by profession, he has published 54 books and has produced 13 dance dramas apart from conducting excavations in 10 historic cities as part of his archaeological work. It's an honor to have you here, sir. Sri Rajiv Malhotraji is an internationally known researcher, writer, speaker, and public intellectual on current affairs as they relate to civilizations, cross-cultural encounters, religion, and science. He studied physics and computer science and served in multiple careers, including software development executive, Fortune 100 senior corporate executive, strategic consultant, and successful entrepreneur in the information technology and media industries. He took early retirement at the age of 44 to pursue philanthropy, research, and public service. He established Infinity Foundation for this purpose in 1994. Rajivji has conducted original research in a variety of fields and has influenced many other thinkers in India and the West. He has disrupted the mainstream thought process, among academic and non-academic intellectuals alike by providing fresh provocative positions on Dharma and India. His game-changing books include Academic Hindu-phobia, The Battle for Sanskrit, Breaking India, Indra's Net, and my personal favorite, Being Different. It's an honor to have you here, sir. I take this opportunity to welcome all the speakers, panelists, participants, and guests to the conference and hope that these 3 days will give you fresh insights to engage with your research domains. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Tripathi. May I now request Sri Rajiv Malhotra ji to give us a few words to set the tone for this conference.
Namaste and welcome to this conference. I'll take a few minutes to basically summarize what is our vision, overall vision, as part of which this conference, and what's the purpose being served. The overall vision that brings us together is that we need to revive, resurrect, modernize the idea of an Indian grand narrative. An Indian grand narrative where we respect the distinctiveness of all the subcultures, all the languages, all the regions, all the communities of all kinds, without anyone being put down, without anyone being inferior to others, all Indians, all Bharatiyas as peers in a very mutually respectful relationship, and at the same time unified, a unity within across all this diversity that brings us together. Now, this Indian grand narrative has existed for a long time, has been disrupted due to various interventions in history, and is now in a state of complexity, I should say. There is a lot of regional differences, conflicts, a lot of international interventions. If you did a survey of 100, a sample of people in every state, as to what is their idea, you'll come up with many different answers, including people saying, we don't think there is such an entity. And I say this from experience. In fact, one of my experiences which was very troublesome was addressing the Indian Foreign Service Institute, where they're training the new diplomats. And I went there and gave a talk twice. I said, I'm here to talk about the idea of India and the Indian narrative because you as diplomats are brand ambassadors of this narrative. And during the Q&A, the room was divided into those who felt very proud, said, we ought to learn this more. We are glad that you are teaching us because none of our education taught us these things. And the other half of the room saying, what narrative, what India? I am from this state. I don't understand there is any narrative. And some people standing up and saying, this idea you're talking about has oppressed my ancestors, things like that. So that gave me the encouragement, the inspiration that we ought to discuss this issue. Because if our own diplomats, who are like our brand ambassadors, are themselves confused and don't even know what it is they're representing, then, you know, why do we have such brand ambassadors? And there's something wrong in our education system, perhaps. So this concept of an Indian narrative is not something that can be imposed top-down. It is something that all of us have to participate and discuss. It has to be something that we all voluntarily want to join because it is better for us. As a unified nation, we'll do better on the world stage. So it has to be something where we have to win over a consensus. We cannot sort of impose a consensus. Now, this Indian Grand Narrative project requires us to harmonize many regional languages and groups. We want to do a similar conference in the Northeast. We want to do a Kashmir conference. So we want to go around regions where there is doubt or controversy about whether or not that region is part of India in a true civilizational sense. Now, this project has a supply chain. We don't view a conference as a sort of a mela, a gathering for a large number of people, but primarily as a gathering of scholars and peers who are working on this topic and who need to exchange ideas with each other and see if they can reconcile and reach a consensus. So this is more of a conference of developers of these narratives. People who are developing some part of this narrative are the ones we have selected after having a call for papers and going through a blind peer review, selecting those we feel are active contributors, debaters. They'll argue, they'll discuss and disagree and agree with each other. That's the kind of people we bring to these conferences. And we produce books after this is done, where all the voices are represented. Dr. Kannan is the editor-in-chief. We'll be launching one book today with Justice Kumar doing the release, and many more are in the pipeline. So we do the conference on a particular module of the grand narrative. So if you think of the grand narrative, you know, as a futurist vision to build a new car, a futurist car, which will be driverless, which will run for a million miles without refueling. Suppose you have a vision like that, and you want to build something new that doesn't exist. Then, you know, there'll be a very elaborate supply chain. You will need somebody who's making batteries for it, new kind of batteries, somebody making tires for it, and you have to take each of these building blocks, each of these modules, and have workshops and look at all the new engineering and the new stuff that is going on, reconcile it, agree, disagree. And then once these building blocks are ready, then they have to be assembled into larger and larger units until you have the whole car. So the Indian grand narrative is something of that sort. And there are many, many building blocks. Each of them requires to be assembled. And each of those assembly requires a conference of experts. So this is more a meeting of experts rather than a sort of release of for the mass market. This is why it is different than the sammelans and the conclaves and the literary festivals, because here we want to bring the experts on a particular topic. And they have the goal of producing a certain output. That output should represent a diversity of views coming together. And then this output fits into the bigger narrative. So the Indian Grand Narrative project will include not only regional conferences, it will include a history of what has happened to us, what was there in the ancient times, the Sanatan Dharma, Buddhist, Jain, all the different dimensions of our civilization, the different influxes that came from outside, both helping us and destroying us. We want to look at the period of destruction from the 8th, 9th century onwards, then the period of the British period, what happened in the European period. This town is very rich in the history of fights between Portuguese, Dutch, French, British, fighting for territory right here in this region. So we want to do all of that. And then the Nehruvian period, which is also a period of destruction for in certain ways. And we so this project has many aspects of the past, taking stock of where we are in the present, and coming up with ideas for the future. That is the whole Indian Grand Narrative Project, and it's not one book, and it's not something one can impose, but a large set of volumes, and many people have to be brought together. The output of this is not only discourse, where we have fair amount of consensus, hopefully among diverse groups, and also books, and also videos, and e-learning courses. We want to develop e-learning courses so a lot of people can be trained, including the Indian Foreign Service, including the IAS people, including swamis and acharyas. They need to be trained because many of them don't understand this kind of a breadth, including professors and teachers, including corporate people, because the corporate people also need to own this civilization as theirs in the work they do and the way they represent in the global stage. In addition to all that, we want to train young scholars to continue this work, because I realize that after doing this for 25 years, I have a limited time and I need to train my successors. So I have set a goal that I want to train 108 scholars to continue my work. And they will be in different specialties, different topic specialties. Some of them will be book writers, some of them will be filmmakers, some of them will be professors, some of them will come from administrative service, get this training, go back and perform a role within the government or and so forth. So this is quite a large project, and within this project, now I'll talk about this particular conference. So this particular conference on Tamil Nadu wants to celebrate Tamil language and culture. Tamil is probably the oldest language in the world which has an uninterrupted history, being used by a large majority of people, now tens of millions, in daily life. Now there is, of course, a grand history of Sanskrit. But you cannot say the same thing that it is the mainstream language for a large number of tens of millions of people and that has never been interrupted throughout its history. You cannot say that about any other language except Tamil, or certainly one of the very few that there are three characteristics I'm bringing together. One is being very ancient. Second, it has never been interrupted by some intervention from a foreign country or whatever and abolished and removed. Never. So this continuity has remained. And the third is that it is spoken by tens of millions of people. This is very distinct, and we are very proud of it. All of us are very proud of it. So, and we are also very proud of the great achievements, the Sangam literature and the whole culture that has existed. And we think that as compared to the celebration in our textbooks given to the recognition given to the Mughal architecture in the Mughal period, we feel that this civilization has not been given its due. And so even though this civilization emerged, this culture, Tamil culture, emerged on our soil, and the Mughal culture emerged somewhere else in the world, still, we have given a huge amount of coverage and respect to the imported civilizations that have come into this country, rather than the indigenous cultures such as the one in Tamil Nadu. So we are here to celebrate all of that. And while celebrating this distinctiveness and this greatness, we also want to show that this is part of India. This is part of the Indian nation. It is not something separate. So we don't want to celebrate it as something un-Indian. We don't want to celebrate it as something at war or tension with the rest of the country. We don't want to say that, okay, there is some big problem that being Tamil means that you got to have a big problem with non-Tamil people, because that is not healthy for us as a nation. So while we want to celebrate the identity and the language and its outputs as something very important for our nation, we at the same time want to do it in the context of the Indian open architecture, the Indian society and Indian culture and history, philosophy, values, as as an open architecture in which a lot of different diverse groups can exist with respect, such as the Tamil people. So there is both a celebration and a unification, not a celebration as a separatist kind of an identity. So this means that there will be panels where we want to debate these issues. There are some people, we've invited opponents, because there are people who will say that Tamil culture should be celebrated as something un-Indian and something where the rest of the country is hostile to us and we are hostile to them, and maybe we are angry at them because they victimized us and there were some foreign Aryans who came and did this to us or that to us and so forth. There is that group, and we welcome healthy discussion. We welcome agreeing, disagreeing, debate, Q&A, that is the spirit with which we are doing this. So all of the sessions are going to be videotaped, and then they'll be put up for the public to decide whatever they want to conclude. We are not forcing a particular view on anybody. And we, as I said, we've gone out of our way to invite and welcome people who may disagree with us, because that's the true spirit of Indian ethos and Indian discourse. So with that, I will conclude and request that try and attend as many panels as you can. I'm going to be on a couple of them. There is some controversy because deliberately we brought people who have a different point of view. And you see, the interesting thing is, if you look at Tamil literature prior to 200 years ago, when there was intervention from overseas, prior to that, you won't find, and I'm not an expert, but I've talked to a lot of experts, you won't find this anger and hatred of others within India. You won't find that. You will not find that, oh, we are victims and those guys did this to us and that to us. After all, such a learned people, such a bright, intelligent people with such a huge output of literature, how would you expect that they wouldn't write something if for these thousands of years, if they felt they were victims? They would have written something. There would be protest literature. There would be this literature saying we are anti, the rest of the country. That has not been the case. In fact, the songs, the festivals, the rituals, the deities, the all kind of things that are happening here for a very long time are quite integrated with the rest of the country. And this will be the topic of Dr. Nagaswamy's talk and an amazing new book where he's analyzing all the relationships between Tamil culture and the rest of India. So thank you for coming. Welcome to all of you. And we look forward to some exciting discussions. Namaskar.
Thank you. We would now like a special address by Sri Vallabh Bhansali. Will you take the floor, sir?
Namaskar. What a delight. More than a delight, it's an honor. It's very humbling to be sitting on the same stage as all the very distinguished, very rare personalities here. Dr. Malhotra outlined this great idea of a grand narrative of India and explained its various dimensions. I was introduced as a person from finance, but I walked a parallel path within. And I must share something from that journey. That India's wisdom has so many unique things. And my experience in the finance field has also taught me that unless you make things very practical, unless you bring a scientific temper here and now to what you are saying, in today's times, people are not easy takers to it. Based on those two insights and my little journey, I want to put out three, four thoughts before you as probably forming a part of this grand narrative. We don't find a parallel example in the world where human endeavor has been so well categorized and in a very encompassing manner. Purusharth, being, calm, earth, dharma and moksha, all being addressed, nothing being left out, all activities of a human being covered very well, all given due respect. It's not only categorization, but also an order, that how it's natural for a being to move from an effort devoted to calm, to earth, to dharma, and to moksha. It's very important how we look at it, in my view, that one thing leads to the other. Pursuit of calm requires earth. Pursuit of earth requires you to understand the working of nature, working of society, which is dharma, and what is the dharma's eventual goal, was moksha. My observation has been that the purusharth, which is mokshanugami, which leads to moksha and which doesn't lead to moksha, can be very different. This whole dimension of going within arises only when you want to put moksha before you. So the thought of dharma, which leads to a good life here and which leads to a good life hereafter, the one of a heaven. The heaven part is common to a lot of other cultures. It was the moksha part which was unique to our culture. The thought of liberation rather than salvation. It's a huge distinction. And therefore, when I find that people proudly talk about someone who has passed away as having become Swargavasi, as an achievement, is probably taking away something from the potential of human life and potential of our culture and wisdom. To talk about moksha is important in a very practical manner also. And that because there are certain dimensions to the thought of moksha. The liberation is a result of something. It cannot be achieved by itself. There are wonderful poets and seers who have talked about it, Kabir being the most leading, but I'm not wanting to get into those citations and quotations here. In a very practical manner, liberation does not happen unless you have overcome all your passions. You cannot see your passions unless you have started serious examination of yourself. You have started to travel within. Traveling within is not possible unless scientifically, physically, we had the ability to go within. The whole concept of pratyahar, for that matter, is that process. And this omniscient knowledge, sarvagyata. So when I look at sarvagyata, again, it's a unique Indian concept. The Western world forever and ever has been very proud of moving in marginal steps. It is a measure of their modesty that they will admit, oh, we were wrong about this scientific aspect, this medical belief, etc., and move on to the new position. It's indeed a measure of their modesty and humility, but it also neglects, it also ignores that, oh, you acted out of ignorance. The whole industrial revolution is a story of that you achieved something, but you also destroyed something. But they do not probably believe at all. We have not been able to position this, that marginal knowledge is dangerous. Commonly we accept half knowledge is very dangerous, but so also is marginal knowledge, because by its definition is half knowledge. But what is the alternative? The alternative was the sarvagyata concept of India. But sarvagyata can happen only with a certain process, and this whole path of moksha has also to be brought about in a scientific basis. It must be that this path had an as scientific path as Dr. Nagaswamy will talk about our architecture, culture, archaeology, and so on. They're all based on principles of nature. And those who are serious meditators can vouch for this. If we all believe that the common narrative of India, whatever be the form, Sankhya, Vedic, Shravan, we all believe in karma, that we are here, that our life is shaped by the karma that we did. If this is an embodiment of my past karma, it's a scientific, to use modern metaphor, or what science calls, or what modern science says, as facts, as data, and derivatives, this is an embodiment of karma. It has certain features. Now, if I have to become liberated, I must eliminate my karma. I must eliminate my passions. That means I must be able to scientifically examine, though this is the effect of this kind of passion, etc. And I will share with you some of the expressions from our scriptures. We have this extraordinary word, a very potent word called asrav. Asrav, you would have heard of drakshasrav and several asravs in Ayurveda, which is a wine. It's an intoxicant. When your passion arises, it is intoxicating. And therefore, our seers and rishis called it asrav. Asrav has another meaning, something which flows continuously. So your karma flows continuously. Karma comes to fruition, and the material that brings forth the effect of karma was called asrav. If I have to be liberated, I must be able to come out of the effect of asrav. And there was a word for it. That practice was called sambar. Samvar, those who are familiar with Sanskrit, samvaran, that you overcome something, you stop something, is called sambar, samvaran. And then there's a physical expression of what happens as a result of that was called nirjara. You had classification of nirjara. Nirjara means flowing out, emptying. You empty a Coke can. That was called nishkam nirmana. That is automatic. It is inbuilt that when you empty something, the shell is left. But that was not good enough, because as you become old, you lose a lot of your passions. But that's not by design. That's by natural elapse of time, etc. What I'm talking about is sakam nirjara. So not getting into greater detail, but pointing to this, that this could be the answer to a lot of the problems of the world, that if we can talk about our purushartha leading to moksha rather than swarg, that the moksha is a scientific process, that we have enough language and literature pointing to this scientific path, and I think modern day meditators, I am a baby still in it, but I can vouch that you can experience each of these very, very clearly, and you experience that how nirjara is enlightening, is specifying, and so on and so forth. All the qualities that are described as Satchidanand or whatever else. I want to use this forum, sir, to invite participation on a research project. Dr. Ramchandran is not here, and he would be the most eminently qualified to guide us in this respect. But it requires contribution from many, many fields, that this process of moksha liberation and sarvagyata is a scientific path. It's not just a philosophical concept. Unless we can bring it to that scientific plane, a lot of our claims will be a matter of conjecture, matter of imagination, and therefore it's more easier to attack such ideas and divide them. I want to just share two more thoughts which I find extraordinary in our traditions. Ishavasyamidam sarvam yat kimcha jagatyam jagat tenatyaktena bhunjitaha magrida kasya svidhanam. In a world obsessed with possessing more and more, democracy is creating various rights, the most important right being right to property, or one of the important rights. Here is an explanation by a rishi of how the world works and dispossessing everybody, saying that, oh, everything that is there in this world is a part of cosmic order. It belongs to the cosmic order. It doesn't belong to you. Do partake of it, but only with the spirit of giving up. Otherwise, you are a thief, you're stealing. What a grand narrative. Completely contrary to property rights. And can anything be more inclusive, more egalitarian, more socialistic, yet giving you the right to partake of it in a responsible manner? All your questions of sustainability, all the frictions, etc. The whole, I was talking to Dr. Malhotra, that we need to do something about this whole obsession with growth and GDP. That is growth possible really at all? What is growth? I take from somebody else, I've taken from nature mother, and I call it growth. Where is my accounting? It's all magrada kasya svidhanam. I'm constantly stealing and feeling richer. I'm always impoverishing somebody. It cannot be. We must do something about it. And the last is this situation described in Buddha's life, that as his pupils multiply, automatically the desire, or not the desire, but the thought comes that, oh, this must be shared with all the people. And as his pupils set out in different directions, Buddha stops them. He says, no, please listen. There is a guideline as to what you will do. He says, charata bhikkhave charikam bahujan hitai bahujan sukhai lokanukampai. This is an expression that is written all over our scriptures. But this is the ultimate guideline. Think about all the copyrights and patenting, which is a part of this marginal knowledge system. And look at what lies at the heart of such a process. That when I patent something, when I copyright something, there are two dimensions to it. One, I could say, because I document it properly, it will retain the integrity of what has been created. I wish it was limited to that. Work of people like Dr. Malhotra lies in that category. But a lot of it lies in the other category, the other dimension, where I want my royalty, my commission to come to me. The moment I have that thought, what does it translate into? As long as somebody pays me my commission, my royalty, it doesn't matter to me what it does to you. Give me my part. Where is bahujan hitai, bahujan sukhai? Where is the benefit of many and benefit good of many? I think this is India. And I think it is time that we attack this whole system of creating knowledge for one's own good, for one's own success, for one's own enrichment. Enrichment and sharing of knowledge cannot go together. After all, the knowledge that comes out to from anybody is also a part of this cosmic order, Ishavasimidam Sarvam. So I think I just wanted to share few of the thoughts which could be a part of this grand narrative. Once again, it is a very humbling experience to be a part of this conference. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for a most thought-provoking talk. May I now request Shri Mohandas Pai to give us his special address.
Namaskar to everybody. When I came here, I was thinking, what should I talk about? Then I said, I'll talk about us as people. Why is there so much of confusion about what we are as Indians? We have a very complex problem in our society. And the complex problem in our society is the complexity of multiple identities. All of us are multiple identities. I'm an Indian. I belong to this country. I'm born here. I'm a South Indian. I live to the south of this country. I'm not a Punjabi. I live to the south. So my south is my identity. I'm a Kannadiga. I live in Karnataka. It's my Janmabhumi. I live in Bangalore. I'm a Bangalorean. Bangalore has a culture. I'm a Konkani. It's my language, my mother tongue, and that's my identity. I'm a Gauda Saraswat. I belong to a group of people who have a distinct identity, rituals, and the way we live. Now all these are built into me, as is built in all of you. And when you have these thousands of intersecting combinations and identities, there is bound to be confusion as to what we are. And this confusion is not there in Western civilization. I am English, maybe Welsh, maybe Scottish. I am a Christian, Catholic or Protestant, and that's it. There is no civilization in the world has this complexity of identities and multiple points of interaction. Some of it creates conflicts. Some of it creates connections. But we need a grand narrative to keep it all together, because it is this grand narrative which our forefathers gave us to keep us together. Now we must ask the question, which large civilization has been conquered and subjugated for 1,000 years by people from outside, yet never succumbed to what it is? And what makes it very unique? And what makes it very unique and survive is this multiple identities we so ingrained into us that no narrative from outside can come and suppress us and make us a standardized product. I think it's very important for us to understand this complexity. And that's why we survive as a civilization, and that's why this civilization survives. The Egyptian civilization is gone, Mesopotamia is gone, all civilizations are gone. There are only two which survive, maybe three, the Japanese, the two small. One is Chinese, but China was never conquered. And China is very homogeneous, China is not heterogeneous. But we are heterogeneous. And the best part of it all, if you're an open system, we don't have dogma. Look at the beauty of this, what our forefathers gave us. We don't have a dogma, we don't have a book, we don't have one single narrative, we don't have one single path of going to wherever you want to go. You can do what you want, and you're a part of the whole. This is the beauty of free thought, the beauty of ultimate freedom. The beauty of a great civilization, which create an open system. I come from technology, we understand proprietary system, open systems and everything. Now open systems are coming back to the fore, especially in IIT Chennai, which is driving this. But we are an open system. You can be an atheist. You can practice anything you want, but you're part of the whole. And this beauty is a problem to many people. It's a problem to many people because they cannot understand how this complexity comes. And that's why this civilization is sustainable, because we reflect nature. We reflect nature. Look at a forest. A forest has thousands of species of flora and fauna. All live together, all feed off each other, all give to each other, take from each other, like Vallabhbhai said, and all survive. And you can't destroy the forest. But once it becomes monogamous, it becomes standardized, it can be destroyed. It can be controlled, because there's only one. There's no points of interaction. There's no creativity. There are no new thoughts. It's all stifling. It's a dogma. One way, one book, one God. There is no one God. God manifests in many forms for us. And we have a Ishta Devata. There is one God, one power, who supposed to create everything. We don't know whether he's there. And we also question that. Is he there? We don't know. We don't even know. We question him. We say he's there. We say the gods were created later. Were they created? Yes, they were created later. Are they there? We don't know. We question every single thing. And we're all part of the whole. Now this complexity is what we need to understand and put into a grand narrative. Because this is the way forward. As a civilization, we live in harmony with nature. We worship nature. Now the world is talking about sustainability, but we have been a sustainable civilization because our civilization is not about the conquest of nature. It's the conquest of self. Like Vallabhbhai said, it's the conquest of the self. When Alexander, it seems, came to India and crossed the Indus and defeated Pushottama, and came and was injured, was sitting down sulking, he saw a holy man in the distance, and he sent his troops to get him to come. And the holy man did not come. So he sent his troops to bring him by force. And he asked the holy man, why didn't you come when I called you? He said, who are you? I am Alexander, Alexander the Great. This holy man laughed out loudly. Alexander the Great, what is that? I am Alexander the Great, conqueror of the world. And the holy man said, oh Alexander, conquer yourself, that the greatest of all conquest. Conquer yourself, because we live with ourselves. And end of it, we die. We are mortal. We are not immortal. We die. And the pathos of that last journey is given in the Mahabharata. When the Pandavas go on the last journey, one by one they fall and they ask some very fundamental questions. And if you read that, you understand the futility of power, the futility of dominance, the futility of unsustainability, the futility of acquisition, the futility of conquest, all the things that give you an urge to do things. Because at the end of the day, you're left with yourself, you're left with your mind, and you leave with yourself, and you have to go meet your maker. And that nobody, no great emperor can escape. So we have to live with this complexity, and this complexity creates conflict. Why does it create conflict? Because each identity tries to dominate the other. It's up to us as human beings to understand where they all link together, to celebrate that, to lead together, so that each of us are different, each of us are the same, and each of us can do multiple things in this very big place called India. Now, this is anathema to people who have ideology. The world is run by ideology. This is anathema to people who have ideology. Anathema to people who want controllers. We are told that the idea of India was given by Nehru. The idea of India is not given by Nehru. The idea of India was in a civilization. The idea of India has always been there. The idea of India is one of multiple identities. The idea of India was debated by a founding fathers who fought for a freedom in the greatest freedom movement of the world. It is debated in the Constituent Assembly. It is encapsulated in the modern society into a constitution. It's not belong to one person or two, three people who write the book or historians who talk about this idea which is under danger. Nothing is under danger. There is no danger to any of us. Nobody can do anything to us. What can they do? Can they destroy a billion people? Can they destroy a billion minds? You cannot. But we have to be united. Even though we are diverse, if we lived in a diverse manner, we have to be united. The day we civilization and attack, the day this country and attack, we have to come together, fight the battle, because our identity is Indians. And we have to keep the invisible. That we are not able to do. We allow the enemy to come inside our homes, conquer us and rule us. Then we got our freedom. And now we are allowing the enemy to come and conquer our mind. Now the battle is for the Indian mind. The leftists in Delhi, the Lutyens media, all these people who rubbish us want to conquer our mind, put their idea of history as the only idea of India, which is not true. And in this idea of India, they're giving priority to invaders who came and suppressed us, who destroyed us. No civilization ever has invaders being celebrated, being told as the purveyors of the civilization, of that culture. It cannot happen, but it happens in India. Why? Because we are good people. We accept everything. We are diverse. We say, okay, you too can do this. And they're trying to suppress it. They're trying to suppress by creating one narrative. Why do you have 300 Ramayanas, 400 Ramayanas? A professor of mine in Canada, once in a Canada seminar, told us, he said, in our ethos, the Ramayana is a grand, you know, grand story talking about us, has to be reinterpreted in the ethos of every generation. Every generation has to reinterpret it and write about it and express itself, and that is our right and that is our duty to do it, because in this expression we give vent to our what we see and what we hear, and we are not stuck in the past to some narrative of some other generation. Now look at this empty, look at this great thought. So we have 300 Ramayanas, 400 Ramayanas, but the central theme remains the same. And that is the Indian civilization. The central theme remains the same. The interpretation goes on changing, and each generation has to interpret in its own thing, but keep the whole together and not fight the whole, because there's no conflict between any of this. We have to find similarities, because in nature there's no conflict. There are small conflicts. A lion will eat a deer because it is food. It'll happen, but it doesn't mean that the forest disappears. The forest will not disappear. Then I want to say, this is unique. There's no one single identity. Now, why do we need a grand narrative to keep us together when we are attacking this battle for the mind? The biggest danger for India is being a digital colony of a Facebook or a Google or anything else in technology, because they can push information, they can push news, what they want you to hear, because they control it, and we have become part of the digital economy. So we must fight this battle to make sure our identities are retained, we are what we are. Next, we are $8.8 trillion in GDP in PPP, we are the third largest economy in the world. Yes, we are poor, but you must read Will Durant, who wrote a book, The Case for India, and he said, India, which was the richest country in the world, was looted by the British to the extent of $450 billion from 1857 to 1930 in 1930 money. And once you read that, you understand the reasons for your poverty. We are a rich country. We are poor people for various reasons. Long thousand years of conquest, colonization, looting of this country, etc. We know that. No country has seen the drain of money going out and still remain. And the drain of money has been so enormous, that no country could come back except India. And we are coming back. We'll be a $10 trillion economy by 2030. We'll be the second or third largest economy in the world. We'll outlive everybody else. With the youngest country, 27 years, we'll outlive Europe. We'll dominate the United States because we are the last 17% of humanity. I'm not saying this as jingoism. I'm saying it's evidence. This is data. It's happening. So I want to end by just making a few suggestions, Rajiv. I'm so happy to be part of whatever you're doing because I think this gannet is required. We must save ourselves and the children from the onslaught of the leftist ideologues who seek to create and put their narrative into mind as the only narrative and rubbish us and our civilization. And we must fight back. Each one of us must fight back. And we must fight back in academic institutions because after Nurul Hasan came, the academic institutions were captured by the left. They don't allow outsiders. They are not, they are like a monogamous forest. So we must make sure we have Department for Indian Civilization Studies in 10 universities without ideology, departments for the study of comparative religions like it's done in the West in 10 different universities, invest in Sanskrit, invest in Tamil, invest in Kannada, invest in your languages, translate the great richness of all our languages into other languages so everybody can communicate, and we must have scholarship. We must create a generation of scholars who are deeply into our own culture, our civilization, yet talk the nature of the world. They can go around the world, like the Buddha sent his bhikkhus to all around the world and preach Buddhism. And for China, we are the West. China is a great book, Journey to the West. It's about going west to get knowledge. So we must do this so that our scholars go around, and we must do this. And for that, we require patronage. We require the rich people of our country, accomplished people, to fund us. And we need our scholars to come. They have to leave. We have to create institutions. And in this conference goes a long way. Thank you very much and wish you all the best.
Next on our agenda is our book release. Just before the book release, may I request our general editor, Professor Kannan, to say a few words about the book, the whole endeavor. And after that, we will have Justice Kumar releasing the book.
Honorable members on this stage and off this stage, it gives me pleasure to speak a few words about the book that is about to be released. I speak as the academic director and the editor of this book. When I was a student, I'm a student of science basically, I chanced to look into a book on economics. The first sentence read, India is a rich country inhabited by poor people. I think something similar holds good for our heritage. Ours is a country of very great heritage, but it is inherited by people who are today culturally illiterate and intellectually inane. It's a great tragedy. It is to remedy this situation that our institution, Infinity Foundation India, and this Swadeshi Indology Conference series has been instituted. In order to combat the academic challenges posed by American Indology, the most virulent of the poisons injected by the West, Swadeshi Indology pitched its battle in challenging the ideas given by Professor Sheldon Pollack of Columbia University. Professor Pollack is very powerful and influential that no Indologist dares to criticize him. And therefore, Rajiv Malhotraji thought that this was the right person to be attacked. We have conducted two conferences on Sheldon Pollack alone. A total of 8 volumes are being produced, each about 250 pages. And these are the result of two conferences that we held. One here itself, IIT Chennai, IIT Madras here, and the other one in IGNCA Delhi. We are issuing volume one of this series of 8 books. And we have tackled only 2 issues in this volume. The statement by Pollock that Sanskrit inspired the Nazis of Germany, an outrageous statement, and 2, that Sanskrit is dead. On the very face of it, you could see that if Sanskrit was dead, how did it influence Nazis to such an extent? Pollock has the most weird of logics. There is no event or statement in our tradition that cannot involve for him politics and structure of power. And in this, he has good company in Wendy Doniger O'Flaherty, for whom there is nothing that does not reek of sex. She invokes Freud at each and every step, and well, you know, Ramachandran has shown what kind of people invoke Freud at every step. Yale scholars have presented their papers in this volume. This volume is entitled Western Indology and the Quest for Power. The scholars who have contributed are from various fields. Professor Gopinath, Ashay Naik, and Konrad Elst have shown the hollowness of Pollock's claim of the influence of Sanskrit on Nazism. Professor Gopinath is a professor in computer science in the Institute of Science, Bangalore. He has shown how the writings of Pollock are full of what may be called the protocols of propagandism. Ashay Naik, a software engineer, has exposed the different brands of Orientalism and the virulent nature of American Orientalism. Konrad Elst, a famous Indologist who has made a deep study of Nazism, has shown how Pollock effectively conceals Hitler's contempt for Hinduism. And he has also shown there was never any trace of genocide in Hinduism that Nazism is famous for. The second part of the book deals with the multiple deaths of Sanskrit that Pollock proposes. Naresh Kuntur, who works in the field of artificial intelligence, shows how the opaque diction of Pollock cannot conceal his devious designs. Satyanarayana Dasa, an M.Tech from IIT Delhi, shows there is an abundance of literature produced in Sanskrit, precisely in the period that Pollock says that there is nothing that is produced in Sanskrit. He produces facts and evidences. Dr. Jayaraman Mahadevan, a director, research department in Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, he holds a mirror to the report of the first Sanskrit commission constituted by the government of India when Nehru was ruling, when Hindutva had not been even championed by anybody, and shows the exuberance of support for Sanskrit from all sections of the society all over the country. The papers of Kannan and Meera, myself and my wife, and also Manojna. So Manojna is an MS from the Institute of Astrophysics, show how Pollock has all shades of academic hypocrisy at his disposal, concealing inconvenient facts, cherry-picking only convenient ones, all to fit his pet theories, begging the question, selective playing up and playing down. One final remark that I may make regarding the writings of Sheldon Pollock, which comes as a generalization deducible from all the writings in this book, all the papers produced in this book. Not one author has questioned the profusion of Pollock's scholarship, but everyone has suspected his academic integrity, which is the most tragic. There is a saying in Sanskrit, Shunav pucham iva vyartham panditiyam shila varjitam na guhya gopane daksham nacha damsha nivarane. The dog's tail serves no purpose, apparently. It cannot conceal its genitalia. It cannot help if it has any need of clearing its itch. Such is scholarship without character. That is the kind of knowledge that we have in Sheldon Pollock. There is another Subhashita which says, Durjanav Parihartavyaha Vidyaya Alankrito Pisan Manina Bhujita Sarpaha Kemasavuna Bhayankaraha. A wicked and a crooked man is to be eschewed even if he be highly knowledgeable. The serpent with its charming gem on its forehead, on its hood, should it not be avoided? You will look into this book and see there are finer gems that you will enjoy yourself. I stop here. Thank you.
I have a special request from Sri Rajiv Malhotra ji for Sri Siddharth Pai and Sri Pranav Pai to join us on the dais to receive the first copies of this book. We will have the book release by Justice Kumar sir and Swami Vigyanand ji also. You have a packet, so both of you, I request that you. We have complimentary copies for everyone in the audience here with us today. Now may I request Justice Kumar, sir, to please address us.
Respected dignitaries in the dais, learned scholars in the audience, all those who are present today in this auditorium, I should say, are very lucky. We heard wonderful expositions from various angles, which gives an idea of what we should do here afterwards. In this book, which is released today, young scholars, after thorough research, have shown how that great man Pollock either has not understood our culture or deliberately tried to misinterpret it. But unfortunately, that misinterpretation has gained some respectability in some corners, and that is a threat to our culture. As Mr. Malhotra put it, we all should be proud about Indian grand culture. And our aim should be to restore it. As I said, this is an assembly of scholars. There is nothing for me to say or to add to what has been said so far. But I have a request or a suggestion to make. We have tried to understand our culture. We are proud of our culture. We are seeing that it is under attack. As Mr. Pai put it, it is an attack on the mind. So we don't need any army ammunition to challenge them. What is required today is those who are already attacked, they should be rescued. And more importantly, the future generation should be prevented from such attack. The best way to do is, you first attack them. You tell them what our culture is. You tell them what is this anti-propaganda which is going on. And I'm sure the strength of our culture will enable them to understand it better, and they will be able to face these challenges and probably repel them better than what we have done. And according to me, that is what is to be done immediately. And Dr. Nagaswamy wonderfully placed before us with authority how our culture has been practiced for more than 2,000 years in this land, the land of Dharma. As he rightly put it, thought is the same, it is the languages which are different, and that is what binds this country together. throughout the country, the thought is the same. And that has been dented now, probably after independence. It is only a dent. If you all make some efforts, that dent could be removed and the glorious culture could be restored to its original pristine beauty. And therefore, my appeal to all of you is, mere having this knowledge for yourself is of no use, as Mr. Bansali put it. This knowledge has to be transmitted to the masses. A handful of scholars, few hundreds of scholars, speaking about this great culture is of no use. Each one of you, I am sure, in your life is able to influence your surroundings. And what is to be done today is, whatever you have learnt, whatever you believe, that is to be transmitted to the persons who are around you, because we cannot hold big seminars or melas to teach this, because nobody will come. Therefore, in our own way, if you are able to disseminate this around us, probably it will take momentum, and in days to come, this dent which has been done to our culture could be effectively met, and it could be removed, and the 2,000 years of glorious history could be restored, not only in Tamil Nadu, but throughout the country, and that is the need of the hour. And I'm sure each one of you are competent, each one of you are capable, each one of you are dedicated to this cause. Only thing is, let us use our own ways, but the consensus should be about our culture, and how we put it across is left to your discretion. Time is up. I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to be present, hear wonderful expositions, and have some interactions with the scholars here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. May I request Swami Vigyananji to give us his special address now.
Namaste. Vanakkam. Can you hear me? I know a little more, Padikarar, Padikaralgar, Padikiran, although you studied Tamil, but I forget. Coming to, as Rajiv Malhotra mentioned in the morning, the purpose of this conference is to create a grand narrative of Bharat. In this grand narrative, first, we have to deconstruct the narrative which is based on lie and fake. And that journey is part of the Infinity Foundation they are doing. Second part is important to re-establish our own grand narrative by our own experiences and by our own scholarship and facts. I will just give you two encounters. You know, morning they were mentioning about the scholarship. I was attending a Indology conference. And how I'm telling you, the professor was mentioning about the cafe intellectual. I will give example, you know. In that conference, from Eastern Europe, one a scholar of Indology was started talking about Rig Veda. And so I understand this fellow is talking wrong. Then I stand up, I ask a question. Have you studied the Rig Veda in proper Devanagari? He told no. Then I asked him, because my confidence increased, I told, have you studied the Siksha of Panini? Panini Siksha, the first book, you know, when we studied the Vedanga, that is the first book. He told no. Have you studied the Panini Grammar Ashtadhyayi? Bala no. Have you studied the Nirukta? Bala no. Have you studied other Vedanga? Bala no. Then I asked, can you read Sanskrit?
No.
Can you write Sanskrit?
No.
Can you speak Sanskrit?
No.
Then I told, how you can talk about the Rig Veda? You fellow don't know the language, you don't know the script. How you can talk about the Rig Veda? You fellows are all fake scholars. Then another fellow, he told, how you can say that we are fake scholar? We are not a scholar of Sanskrit. I told, yes, I am giving example. We were colonized fellows. We were colonized. During the colonization period, even after that, we learn English. Not we learn only English. We create a prose, poetry, fiction, drama in the English. Tell me in the last 150 years, you European scholar, I'm not making any racist and biased comment, but I am asking you, European scholar, tell me how many of you have created prose, poetry, fiction, drama in Tamil, Sanskrit language? Is very, very, and many of you have written few sloka, not any great prose, poetry, fiction, drama and composition. And we composed, wrote, fiction, drama, everything. And you fellow have recognized us by giving all the best award of the English literature, even the Nobel Prize also. But you tell me you fellow have not created a single scholar, and your scholarship is all fake scholarship. And I am giving how your scholarship fake. I don't know how many of you heard the name of Achar Hazari Prasad Divedi. Achar Hazari Prasad Divedi was a great Hindi scholar. He used to give, very sarcastic lecture and very, So one of lecture he told, that I am a scholar, Yes, yes, Guruji, we know that you are a scholar. You know that secret of my scholarship? No, we don't know. I will tell you my secret of scholarship, how I am a scholar. He narrated his own story, ki I am a Acharya of the Jyotis. One day Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore requested Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya to send a Sanskrit scholar from Banas Hindu Vishwavidyalaya to the Santiniketan. There was no Sanskrit type, so a scholar thinking, they told ki Achar Hazari Prasad Devadi is a good person, he's a scholar of Sanskrit, send him. So all Ramchandra Sukla, everybody pushed him, why not you go there? He is telling, look, I'm a Jyotish Acharya, how can I teach Sanskrit, In those days, Jyotish, they study Sanskrit, they study Vyakaran. But a specialization was not in the grammar and philosophy and literature. They told, no, you are a scholar, you go there. He went there because all the big fellows are telling him, he went to Santiniketan. Then he went to Gurudev, reported to Gurudev, Gurudev, I have come because Panditji has sent me Malviyaji. Yes, yes, yes. You have to teach a Vedic scholar about Sanskrit. He told, I got scared. How I have to teach a Vedic scholar about Sanskrit? Because generally, Vedic scholar, you are a great scholar of Vedic literature. At least you should know the language, philosophy, all Vedanga, Upanga, and other things. Then he got scared. He told, look, I got scared. I have to teach to the Vedic scholar. Then I asked Gurudev, do I have to go to his place to teach him or he will come to my place? Gurudev told, no, I will send that fellow to your place to teach him Sanskrit. Then one day that fellow came to my place. I have to start teaching him Sanskrit though. Then I asked him from where I should start, because you are a Vedic scholar, from where I should start teaching Sanskrit to you? No, from wherever you want, you start. So it gave me another surprise. He's a Vedic scholar and he's telling me you to start from wherever I want. Then he asked, can you start from a start alphabet? That is Ayyunri Lirik Pratyahara Sutrani? Yes, you can start from there. Then again I wonder, you fellow have written several books on Vedas and how you don't know all those things? So he told you don't know. So then he told the secret of his scholarship. See, writing book on Veda is very easy thing nowadays. You don't know, there is no need of a scholarship. You just collect 10 books available in the bookshop and market, 10 books, start reading and create a 10 box. And start reading, taking notes, and each subject put in each box. And when all 10 books you read, you will have a 10 box full. And compile the one subject and that is one book on Vedas. So this is the secret. This is the secret of a scholarship. This is how I learn all my scholarship, So this is the Western scholarship of Indology or Veda and Shastra and Sanskrit. We need to deconstruct them. We need to expose them. You are not a scholar first. And they are not a scholar. I will tell you another example, Once Atalji went to Germany some year back, almost 10, 12 years back when he was prime minister. He praised German. Oh, Germans are great Sanskrit scholar there. I was in London. People asked me, Bharat mein itni durgati ho gayi kya nahi? They asked me in Hindi, ki Bharat mein Sanskrit ki itni durgati ho gayi hai kya? Then I told, no, even in any of our taluka, there are more greater Sanskrit scholars than entire in the West. Same example I gave, look, Our even now Sanskrit teacher can read Sanskrit in Devanagari, can translate, create some prose, poetry, everything. But European fellow cannot, so they are not a scholar. So this part we have to expose them and deconstruct them. Second thing, I will tell you, he was talking about the unity in our society. North, south, east, west. I was invited by a World Saiva conference in Malaysia. I told, look, why you are inviting? I'm not a Saiva scholar. I'm a Sanskrit scholar traditionally and from the Vedantic tradition. I'm not a Saiva scholar. Why you are inviting me? No, no, you should come. You should choose your subject. So I told, look, being a Sanskrit student, I will choose Kashmiri Saivism. I went there. I spoke on the Kashmiri Saivism. But I saw the conference with all the, you know, Dravidian, you know, a scholarship in the guise of Saiva. All the Dravidian scholarship in the guise of Saiva. And in that, there was a few discussion, you know. One fellow was talking about all our origin, Dravid, Dravid, Dravid. Then I asked him, can you tell me in your literature, from the right from the very beginning to the end, in your Tamil, don't refer the Sanskrit, in your Tamil literature, where is this Dravid word? Where is this Dravid word in your Tamil literature? If there is no Dravid literature, how you are claiming that you are Dravid? This Dravid word very much is a Sanskrit word. Then, second thing about the language, Nagaswami will agree with me and Professor Kannan also. In ancient time, there were many schools of grammar, Saraswat grammar, Maheshwar grammar, Vyakarana, I'm talking the Vyakarana, Maheshwar grammar. Several grammar schools are there. And surviving school, which is now left in the Sanskrit grammar, is a Maheshwar grammar, which is a our Panini Astadhai. And if you go to the Talka Pina, Aindra grammar school. Whole Talka Pier is based on Aindra grammar. And this is all Talka Pier has recorded. And even old scholarship, you know that P.S. Subramanya Sastri, all those people have written the book on the Panini grammar and Talka Pier grammar. So these are the things we also need to. Some greater scholar, we need to expose them ki what the misinterpretation and bogus intellectual theories coming in the name of class and differences in the languages. I will just give you one example how they are simple. You know, I just came yesterday evening from Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, they say Om. Here in Tamil Nadu, you say yes, Am. Same thing in Swaradhi Gan of Gan part of Panini grammar, you see, they are Om and Am both there. So I'm just giving you one example. So these are the how our languages are united. Coming to the same Sri Lankan conference, the Saiva conference in Malaysia, one gentleman suggested, because we are all Tamil, we don't know Tamil language, we don't know Sanskrit language, these Brahmins are doing puja in Sanskrit. We should not do puja in Sanskrit. So we should do puja in Tamil. But good thing was that there were many Sri Lankans who migrated, you know, in the European country after the LTT war 83. Now they are grown up. They are in Norway, French, Dutch, different country. Then those young boy told, look, we are grown up in this country. We don't know Tamil either. Are you going to do this puja in Dutch, Nordic, French, British? So I'm telling you, we need to question them, these type of people, you know. Coming to this, create a scholarship, you know, after IIT, I went to study Sanskrit in Gurukul. I spent 10 years studying Sanskrit. I studied complete Panini grammar from Guru Parampara, entire Vedang, Upang, Brahman, Sanhita, everything. My whole dream learning in Sanskrit was to create a scholar. And my idea of a scholar, which I have written somewhere, we should produce a scholar in a such a way, in a such a good quality, they can tell anywhere in the world, any scholar of the world, gentleman, what is known to you is known to me. But what I know, you don't know. If this type of a scholar we can create, then we can, you know, challenge them and deconstruct those fellows who are talking all nonsense about and making, you know, big lie about our own narratives. And the last, yesterday I was telling to our Balla Bhai, ki look, in our tradition, in Sanskrit tradition, this moksha has come, is not very imposed for the grihastha, you know. Grihastha, for grihastha in our sastra is everywhere mentioned trivarga, dharma, artha, kama. For renunciate brahmachari or renunciate banprist in sannyasi, they are more talk about the moksha. And he all validated from his all Tamil, you know, literature, which validated my Sanskrit knowledge. Coming to the last, he also mentioned one, ki Chola king were mentioning that ki we are the descendant of the Manu. See, I always claim, I told you, no, I said Vanakkam, not because I wanted to please you. Not because of please you. I wanted to mention you here today in Bhagavat Mahapuran. Bhagavat Mahapuran, have you heard the name of Bhagavat Mahapuran? Srimad Bhagavat Mahapuran. In Chaturvinsu Adhyayana, 14th chapter, which is related to the Matasya Avatar and Navama Skanda, clearly the sloka mentioned that the last Manu, which you are mentioning, the last Manu is not from the North India. We are all the descendant of the last Manu. The last Manu is from the South India, Dakshin Bharat, Dravideswar. And I am reading the sloka. Yo asau satyabrato nama Rajarsi Dravideswara, Rajarsi Dravideswara, Jnanam yo atita kalpante lebhe purusha sevaya, sa vai vivasvat putro manushaditi srutam tatasta srut chokta ichvaku pramukhanipa. Even all the ichvakus are all descendant. So in historically also it is all recorded. There is no such type of division. We are the one who have created division by this fake scholarship. So we have to deconstruct them again, this fake scholarship. Coming to
we are the original people.
Yeah, we are all original. Everybody.
North India is fake.
No, no. North Indian also are the same descendant.
Okay. They went north.
See, the story is that during the Mahakalpa, when the Matsya Avatar, he took all the space in the boat and they took shelter in the Himalaya. So from where the whole generation come. So our ancestry is the same. So there is no such type of thing, even in, I am talking about, this is not written by me, this is all in the Srimad Bhagavat Mahapuran. And coming to the last, he was talking about unity. I am not very impressed by the unity. Unity is already inbuilt in our society. It's very much, I always call, we are the most united society in the world, you know. Most united society in the world. I don't want to give lecture here. I always tell, look, Muslim has a one Bible, Quran, they have one Allah, and they have one prophet. But they are not united. Can you see that? How many, they have firqa and sect, and from the day one they are fighting, Shia, Sunni, they do not accept each other as Muslim. Shia do not accept Sunni as a Muslim. Sunni do not accept Shia as a Muslim. Both they do not accept Ahmadiyya as a Muslim. And Shia cannot go to the Sunni mosque, Sunni cannot go to the Shia mosque. Even after that, they are divided. They cannot be buried in the same graveyard. They are not a united society. Same in Christianity. You go search in the Google, there are 40,000 denominations in Christianity. They believe in the same Jesus Christ. They believe in the same Bible. They believe in the same God. Forget, there are 12,000 registered denominations. If you don't know, there are 400 denominations which have intercontinental presence. And each one criticize each one. Each one do not recognize each one as another Christian. Even same, forget about this. Catholic do not accept Protestant as a Christian. And Protestant do not accept Catholic as a true Christian. And also they are fighting. From the very beginning they are fighting. I don't want to go in detail. I deliver lecture hours and hours on this subject. That unity in the Hindu society. They are also divided. They are fighting. And they are also divided after the death. You know, same they are... What is called graveyard? Kya bolte hain? They have a
cemetery.
Their cemetery is different. So they are not united. I always give example, they are like a pomegranate, you know. From outside look one. The remove the skin, pomegranate pieces are falling apart. They are like that. We as a Hindu, we are very united society. We are like a watermelon. From outside look one, but you cut inside, we are one. If you cut the watermelon, inside there is only one piece. So I'm not very Unity is very much ingrained in our society. But what is different? We are united like a laddu. Laddu ko dusre log kha jate hai na, other eat the laddu. So what is the answer? We have to convert this soft laddu in the hard laddu from where Ballabhai is coming. And there is a laddu in Mumbai that is known as a kalak laddu. Next time, you should distribute each laddu to these people. That laddu is really hard. Same laddu. No, very hard to eat, you know, very hard to eat. We have to convert this unity into organization. Unity is abstract now. We need efforts for that. That is more important. Namaste.
Thank you. Now for a few words from Sri Rajiv Malhotra ji.
So I want to thank a lot of people who've participated in bringing this together. But first I want to just clarify a couple of things. We could go on forever. I think we've stirred up a lot, and this is what the conference is for. The next 2.5 days is with the real substance of the conference. Just to clarify, my book, which is The Battle for Sanskrit, a critique of a certain school of thought, actually goes out of its way many, many places. I make a conscious effort to complement the detailed hard work, rigor of the Sanskrit scholars in the West that I'm critiquing. I don't knock them down, no ad hominems. Don't think that they are fools. They don't. See, it's one thing to take on the opponents in the cafe or those who don't know they even agree. Then you are taking on the easiest opponent. Actually, there is more strength in taking on the strongest opponent to knock down, to really critique the best opponent is what it takes, not the weakest opponent. In fact, Adi Shankara did not go to some random guy when he went to the top people. That is our tradition. You want to knock down a school of thought, you go to the best of their best. So the best of their best, when you look at, they've spent 20, 30 years, they know Devanagari, they speak, they know Sanskrit, the Western Indologists, if you look at the very best ones, are highly educated. They really know Sanskrit. In fact, as Kannan has pointed out, we have tried for many years getting our traditional scholars to give response to them. Our traditional scholars can explain, recite, chant and all that, but cannot respond because they have not read the other side, and without doing Purva Paksha of the other side, you cannot give Uttar Paksha. And to do Purva Paksha or critique of the other side, you got to know their language, you got to know the philosophy which they're referring to. They're referring to Hegel philosophy, which nobody here knows, or they're referring to Gadamer or whatever they're referring to. Our people need to understand that, which has not been done. So to knock down, to take on the toughest and strongest of the opponents requires a whole new type of thinking which our traditional scholars don't have. So we have to understand that. We can knock down the trivial ones here and there, but that doesn't suffice. I would say to implement the program we have started, we want to take whatever school of thought it is, whether it is Davidianism in this conference, or whether it is, you know, New Orientalism in the previous two conferences, or whatever topic it is, we want to take on the finest, best, top, most powerful scholar as the reference point and give a response to them. Otherwise, if we just trivialize and make fun of their weak people, we will live in a world of self-glory and arrogance and chauvinism, but we are not going to really address the issue of being able to change the game. To change the game, you have to understand how the game is played, which institutions in the world have power, from where all this knowledge comes, gets spread into media, gets spread into your education system, into civil services. You have to really understand all the institutions and organs of society which are part of the knowledge, whether it's Wikipedia, whether it is Google or the new kind of systems. You have to really understand all of the mechanisms. And then you have to figure out where are the real centers which we have to tackle. And those are exceedingly powerful. They've been funded for a long time. They have huge budgets, and they're not trivial people. So I would say we should, I prefer respecting the opponent, for his strengths and then taking him on. Because otherwise, our people are very lazy. A lot of people, a lot of scholars we've come across are sort of think there is nothing to fight because we already have won the fight. Well, if you've already won the fight, go out and see what our youth are, how they are misinformed. We can't on the one hand say we got problems and on the other hand say we don't have problems. If we have problems, we really need to address those problems seriously. So we are taking on, in our series, we're taking on the best of the best opponents. And they are the ones we want to address. So even here, we invited Dravidian separatists, Dravidian scholars. We want them to come. And we want these panels to have these kind of debates. I'll be personally involved in one of those discussions later this afternoon, so you guys are welcome to come for that. We want civil debate, but we don't want to trivialize that they're not any good and all that. We respect them. Second thing I want to say is our grand narrative project has both disruptive modules and constructive modules. We are not just out knocking down this guy, criticizing that guy. That is not what it is. Infinity Foundation, 17 years ago, started the first ever multi-volume series on the history of Indian science and technology. And we have 14 volumes produced. We do not know anybody else who has done that. Now, this is not knocking down anybody. It's the history of metallurgy, the history of civil engineering, the history of irrigation, the history of agriculture, and all that, each done by important scholars in places like IIT and Banaras Hindu University and various places, and each getting three to five year grants to do this project. That's constructive. It's not knocking down or any of that stuff. So I don't want you to think that we are just about criticizing, knocking this or that person. We are doing a multi-volume series on Indian mind sciences. In fact, in March, we have a joint conference, a Swadeshi Indology conference with Delhi University on Indian mind sciences. And that is to talk about from the earliest Buddhist, Jain, Kashmir Shaivism, Patanjali, all that stuff to modern, discoveries of the mind and so on, and compare it with the Western theories of mind. So we are doing constructive work. It is not disruptive work. This is constructive work. So we are also looking at how Indian ideas of society, social sciences, right now there is no, if you look at the universities, there is not a single curriculum on Indian models of social sciences. So social sciences people are all, they've imported ideas from the left, from the West. So we have to acknowledge the fact that there's a few tens of thousands of social science people produced in India from hundreds of universities over the last 2-3 generations, and they do not have any Indian model of social sciences. So we got a real problem. We are not going to go back and live like 5,000 years ago, people. We have to go forward because the technology is different, the population density is different, the ecosystem is different. We cannot go back in time. We have to go forward. So how do we go forward? Taking our knowledge is a new challenge. We have new smritis to write. We have to write new interpretations of the old smritis and new smritis to write for today's relevance. So it's a huge amount of work. We cannot trivialize this and say that, we just criticize a few easy targets and feel that, okay, our job is done. I think our job is requires a very large number of very dedicated, smart people for a very long period of time. It is not an easy thing to do. And the final thing I want to say is, how do we create and disseminate new knowledge to a very large audience? There's two ways. The common way being followed is that you have a very large population sammelan, a gathering of not 200-300 people, but thousands of people, a big mela, huge Ramlila ground, and you give very passionate slogans, and you measure the success based on how many thousands of people came. So that is, the person with knowledge or ideas or opinions disseminating directly to a large audience. That's one way to do. We're not going to do it that way. We decided that this knowledge needs to be turned into institutional curriculum, put into universities. It needs to put into media. So in other words, between the knowledge producers and the public of crores of people lie a channel of distribution. So it is not direct. It is not that somebody makes a car and then he sells it directly. He has dealers. He has a distribution channel. Whatever product you make, you have retail channels, you have wholesalers. So in other words, you have to get leverage to distribute widely. And to distribute our knowledge widely, the retailers we're looking for are, you know, institutions of knowledge. We want to train Swamis and Acharyas to come and learn because each of them has a retail business of teaching. We want teachers to be trained, professors to be trained, civil servants to be trained. So our strategy is to use existing institutions and maybe create new institutions and put this knowledge through that in order that we have a force multiplier rather than going directly to the public. I would like to conclude by thanking professors from IIT who've made this very possible. This is not the first such event. We've done several of them before. Professor Jalihal, Karmalkar, and Tripathiji. Really want to thank them. The volunteers from IIT, a whole lot of people have volunteered. I'd like them, they're wonderful people. I'd like to thank supporters like Sri J.K. Jhawar, who's sitting there, who's, he's put many of our staff in India on his payroll as a way of helping us out. Mohandas Pai, who's been very helpful and very supportive with resources. Vallabh Bhanshali ji, Nagesh Bhandari ji from Indus University. Now that's an example where we are in collaboration. They have a university in Ahmedabad, and we are in collaboration with the intention that the knowledge we produce, we can actually distribute it through them. So we want several such universities in collaboration where we are then going direct. We're going to go through other intermediaries such as them. I'd like to thank Dr. Ramachandran for a brilliant talk. He flew all night and arrived here early hours of this morning with his wonderful family and has come all the way for this. And I'd like to thank Dr. Nagaswamy for a wonderful talk. See, now that's an example of not rhetoric and sort of chauvinism, but rigor. He actually takes Tamil culture, Sanskrit culture, finds out the correlates, and in his book, he's documenting all the sources. So if people disagree, I think it behooves them to read his book where all the evidence is cited and then raise these issues. And I'm sure he'll be very happy to do that. I would like to thank Justice Kumar, who's come all the way from Bangalore. Swamiji, Swami Vigyananand, we are old friends from way back, and we have a lot of interactions back and forth. And I want to thank the editor of the previous series on Professor Kannan. And you know, a number of scholars, we have been giving stipends to produce the research that gets published. And I'm not going to name all of them, but they are the backbone. And we have a staff in India now, several staff, several volunteers. I'd like to appreciate the work they have done. And none of this would have happened. The Infinity Foundation was for 25 years in the US. And we just didn't think it's possible to get started in India. And it was Vijaya who told me and convinced me that you really need to turn over everything, transfer everything, build infrastructure, staff in India, and I'm very glad that we are doing that because my own goal is whatever I've started, I mean, I've taken it this far and whatever, and I need to build some teams and infrastructure in India, young scholars, and with different specialties. Their job is to take it much further than I could ever have imagined. That is the best thing I could have done. So I want to conclude by saying all of, and also of course the audience that have come for 3 days, thank you very much. We will do certainly two conferences in the first half of next year. One on we have finalized a deal with Delhi University on the mind sciences, and then we are now negotiating with the National Museum in Delhi, which is part of the Archaeological Survey of India, to do a conference on Saraswati River, because they have tremendous data, satellite, whatnot. And probably in the second half, another conference. We have five or six always working in the pipeline, and we want to do, you know, a couple of conferences a year. Each a building block, a module of the whole grand narrative. So whether it is the mind sciences module, whether it is the Tamil Nadu module, the Northeast module, the Muslim period module, the history of mathematics module, they're all modules for the grand narrative. And each has to be done with academic rigor and published properly. And this whole thing is the Indian grand narrative. Then it has to be turned into videos, documentaries, films, YouTube, all of that stuff. It has to be turned into e-learning. So this, to reverse 1,000 years of, you know, all kind of problems that have we faced, like Swamiji said and others have said, is a huge job that we have to do. It is not going to happen quickly, but with your help, we at least got started. Thank you very much.
May I request Professor Karmalkar to present the vote of thanks, please.
I just noted that Rajivji has already thanked most of the people. So I had made a list of those who need to be thanked, and there are just a few remaining. So I will thank them and just make closing statements. So I would like to thank from my side all the speakers for such an enlightening all of us. And before I summarize what they have said, I would like to thank some of those who need to be thanked, such as the coordinators Shalini and Aditya. I think they have worked tiringly. And then student volunteers, there are a number of them, so I'm not taking their names, who have worked behind the scenes. And then I would like to thank all of those people who are going to ask investigative questions, because as Rajivji has said, that this is an academic setting where we welcome opposing points of view. And so please, all those people who would like to seek clarifications, this is the place for doing that, and we'll make proper arrangements to let you speak your mind. Now let me just summarize what all the speakers have said. So, and also I would like to thank the scholars who did the Vedic chanting and Tevaram chanting in the beginning. Then going one by one for the speakers, Bansaliji, I'm just going to tell one line about each of them, some takeaway from their speeches. So Bansaliji said, the difference between liberation and salvation. He talked about that. Mohandas Pai talked about multiple identities and mentioned how the presence of multiple identities has actually helped us survive and also thrive. Dr. Ramchandran mentioned how theories coming out from social sciences departments should be corrected based on scientific advances, particularly about the functioning of the brain and how that has influence on our understanding of the functioning of the brain, influences the theories and which need to be discarded. Dr. Nagaswamy drew parallels between Sanskrit and Tamil and showed how they are basically talking about the same thing in different languages. Kannan sir has done this job of editing this volume, and he mentioned some jewels from there. Particularly his Subhashitas were very interesting, and all of us should probably go through them. They are available in the volume. Justice Kumar stressed the importance of our transferring all this knowledge to our next generation in a proper form. And finally, Vigyananji stressed the importance of organization and providing strength. So I think with that, I close my remarks. And I thank all the attendees also for coming here and spending 2-3 days here to exchange ideas and discussion. Thank you.